Welcome. We are looking at the solution for the diffusion equation. We are looking at equations of this type, right? This is 1D diffusion equation. Okay. So what we are trying to do is to solve this equation numerically, and we said that there is explicit method and there is implicit method. Okay, you can use either of them. And while doing that, we said that there are different boundary conditions. One is Dirichlet, the other one is Neumann. So we have seen models, scripts where you can implement these boundary conditions and solve this problem. Now there is another kind of boundary condition which is slightly different from this, which is sort of mathematical. I mean, it does not follow from physics, or it follows from physics, but from a completely different type of argument, but it is used for some purpose. So I want to spend a couple of minutes discussing what this boundary condition is and why it is there in the first place, and then we will go back to solving the diffusion equation using octave with this particular boundary condition implemented. Okay. Now this boundary condition is known as periodic boundary condition. Okay. So periodic boundary condition. The origin of periodic boundary condition is slightly different. See, when we said Dirichlet or Neumann, we took the actual system, right? I have this and it has some diffusion barrier. So the diffusion takes place along only x axis. So I am then, and then I am considering cases where I put this end at some concentration and then keeping this end at some concentration, or making sure that I put a diffusion barrier here also so that there is no flux. So these are the type of boundary conditions when we talk about, then we get to Dirichlet and Neumann boundary. But think of a different case. Suppose I have a very long rod, right? For all practical purposes, it goes to infinity on either side, right? This is x, let us say the 0 for x is somewhere here, and so this goes to minus x. Okay. So these values are running from one infinity to another infinity for all practical purposes. Because suppose I am interested in one part of this rod and I am interested in what happens here, because this is say representative volume element. So this is another terminology that is used, okay, especially in finite element and solid mechanics context. So this is sometimes known as RVE. Okay. So I am going to consider a portion of this system. I am interested in what happens in this, because I believe that this entire infinite system is basically consisting of units like that. I mean, this is say repeated infinitely, like this is repeated and that is repeated. Here on this side, this is repeated, etc. Suppose I say that it is sufficient to look at what happens in this volume, because that is what is happening in every volume. So this is sufficient to solve, right? Some of you who have looked at electronic properties will understand this, because when we do band structure and such calculations, we do not do it for the entire crystal. We do it for the unit cell and say that because the crystal consists of repeating unit cells, whatever is happening in one unit cell is going to happen in all the other unit cells, and that is how we are getting the results done. So in the condensed matter or solid state physics, lots of times you use this boundary condition. This boundary condition is known as periodic boundary condition. Sometimes people also call it as cyclic boundary condition. You will see why. An example of this is that suppose I tell you that I have a composition profile which is sinusoidal. Then it is sufficient for me to choose one wavelength and look at the domain for one wavelength, because everything that is happening in the other boxes will be basically repetition of the same thing. So it's sufficient for me to look at one wavelength, right? In fact, that is the case that we are going to solve, because remember we said that if you have a sinusoidal composition profile, then classical diffusion equation predicts that this will come down and this will go up, this will not change, so that the composition becomes something like this after some time, something like this after some time, and then it becomes a constant after a very long time. So this is what we want to see. Now if suppose I have more than one wavelength in my system, it is not necessary for me to look at all wavelengths, right? I can just restrict myself to one wavelength. And suppose my system consists of a length which consists of two wavelengths, then whatever is happening in this wavelength is basically a repetition of this, or it could even have three wavelengths, you know, on this side. So it doesn't matter. I mean, it is sufficient for me to look at only this side. That is why it's called cyclic, right? I mean, what we are going to do is that this is going to get repeated. So how do we do that? Let us look at from the point view of discretization. What do I have when I discretize? I have this domain, I have I equal to 1, I have 2, I have 3, etcetera, I is equal to n. Remember the boundary condition we needed, because when I equal to 1, there is nothing to the left of this. When I equal to n, there is nothing to the right of this. Now when we say cyclic boundary condition, I mean that this is the reason why it is called cyclic boundary condition or periodic boundary condition, because we are assuming that whatever is there in this cell is getting periodically repeated. So that is why it is periodic boundary condition. What we tell is that let us assume for I equal to n, the point to the right is the same as I equal to 1. That is, I am repeating this unit say again. What will happen? This will become I equal to 1, this will become I equal to 2, etcetera, right? So when I have I equal to n, I can assume that the point to the right of n is nothing but the leftmost point. Similarly, when I have I equal to 1, because remember, I mean, if this is getting repeated on this side also, then this point will be actually I equal to n, because this will be I equal to n minus 1 and so on, right? So we are assuming that this is a representative volume and the same thing is getting repeated on either side, which means for I equal to 1, I equal to n becomes the left neighbor, and for I equal to n, I equal to 1 becomes the right neighbor. So when we reach a point which is n plus 1, basically what we are saying is subtract n from that, right? When you have I plus 1 which becomes equal to n plus 1, then just subtract n. Similarly, when you go to I equal to 1, when you are looking at I equal to 1 minus 1, that is 0, we say just add an n to it. In other words, your range is from some 1 to n. Whenever you go above this, you subtract n from it. Whenever you go below this, add an n to it and map the points back to this domain. This is, like I said, done very extensively in condensed matter physics. You might have seen band structures, you might have seen how the band structure is plotted, they have names like Wigner site cell, so everything folds back to the first Wigner site cell or whatever, okay. So similar thing is what we are doing. This is very important because we are going to do it in this context. But later we are going to use spectral methods, and spectral methods always implicitly assume this kind of periodicity and periodic boundary condition, okay. The implementation for spectral methods, the periodic boundary condition is a little bit involved, but the idea is the same. So I have one domain, I need points to the left of the domain and to the right of the domain. Whenever I need them, whenever I go outside of the domain, depending on whether I am going above n or below 1, I am going to either subtract or add n, which is the size of the domain, okay. If I do that, then the result is what is known as the periodic boundary condition. So let us take the explicit method, because that is very, very easy to implement, and let us implement periodic boundary condition for the explicit implementation and solve the diffusion equation for an initial profile which is like a one wavelength, okay. So that is the, this is the, at time t equal to 0, so this is the initial condition. And because I have periodic boundary condition, I have gotten rid of the two boundary conditions. So instead I am going to impose the periodic boundary condition. As you can see, in effect what the periodic boundary condition has done is that it has gotten rid of these two boundaries, these two surfaces, right. When I had a system like this, this was one surface, this was one surface. So I was implementing boundary conditions on these two surfaces. So I have gotten rid of those surfaces here. There is no surface, right. This just continues, this just continues. I have arbitrarily chosen some region and I am working on it. Now sometimes people tend to say that when you implement periodic boundary condition, the system is infinite. That is not quite correct. Okay. The system is not having any boundaries or surfaces, but that does not make it an infinite system, because this you can understand very, very easily. Suppose by mistake, instead of taking one full wavelength, I took half a wavelength and did my calculation and assumed periodic boundary condition, right. Then I will have a problem, because in that case I am not having something that is like this, but instead I am going to have something that is like this, right. Now periodic boundary condition you have implemented. So well, this system where you have taken one full wavelength and repeating it will correspond to something which is like the infinite system, because we have gotten the full information and everything else is repetition. This is not, I mean this is a completely different system. If the composition is like this, yes of course you can take this and the periodic boundary condition works and makes it infinite. But so this is the concept related to representative volume element. Unless the unit cell that you are assuming, over which you are implementing periodic boundary condition, is actually completely representative of the system, it really does not, the results are not equivalent to what you would get from an infinite system. In other words, there is a system size effect. Unless you have gotten rid of it completely, periodic boundary condition does not imply infinite system. But in all cases where periodic boundary condition is implied, it implies that there are no surfaces or boundaries in the system. So it is a way of getting rid of surfaces and boundaries, and if it is chosen appropriately, the system will mimic an infinite system. But it is not necessary that every time you implement periodic boundary condition, the system will actually mimic an infinite system. So this is something that you need to keep in mind. So let us go implement a periodic boundary condition for an initial profile which is sinusoidal like this, okay. Of course, as usual, we are going to open, every time you open a terminal, go to the relevant directory. I do it several times so that you will remember. Many a times, because you will not do this, you will get lots of error messages. So we do not want that, okay. So then we open a text editor and we save a file. Let me save as, it has to be saved in the same directory from which you have invoked Octave. That is another reason why I am doing it every time to show you. Let us do, so this is also 1D diffusion equation, but with periodic boundary condition. So explicit PBC to say that it is periodic boundary condition, and 1D diffusion dot OCT, 1D diff dot OCT, right. Explicit periodic boundary condition, 1D diffusion in Octave, right. So this is the file. Of course, what do? We start with CLF and clear, okay. The next step is to put the del T is equal to, let me put some small value, 0.001, del X equal to some 0.5, okay. So let us do that. And D is equal to 1.0, alpha is equal to D into del T divided by del X into del X, okay. So we have defined alpha, I am going to define the system size, I am going to define N is equal to 128. You will typically see that when we use spectral techniques, the numbers that we take for the system size is 2 power N. Okay, it is like 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, 1024, 2048, and things like that, 4096. So we go in this because Fourier transforms work better if you take the system size to be 2 power n. It is not necessary in the case of finite difference, but just to indicate that sometimes you can take the system size. It does not have to be from 0 to 100, it could be 1 to 128. So that is why I am taking it to be 128. Okay. And typically if you are using Fourier transform based spectral techniques for solving, it is always better to take the number something like this. Okay. So I have defined the total number of points. So I am going to define the initial condition. For defining the initial condition, I am going to define what is known as M. M is basically the number of wavelengths that you are going to include in the domain. Okay. In our case, we said it is one single wavelength. Okay. It could be more than one wavelength. You can put 2, then it will put 2 sinusoidal waves. You can put 3, it will put 3 sinusoidal waves and so on. Okay, so let me make m equal to 1. So for I equal to 1 to n, what are we going to do? So I am going to define a old C and a new C. Okay, old C of I is equal to 0.5 into 1 plus sin of 2 into pi into m into I into del x divided by n. Okay. So this is very important to note. What is it that we are doing? We are saying that the initial profile is sinusoidal, but remember sine goes from 0 to the minus 1 to 1, but our composition profile should go only from 0 to 1. So I am going to add 1 to sine, that is going to make it go from 0 to 2, and then I am going to multiply that by 0.5, so that the composition is now going to run only from 0 to 1. That is the reason why it is here. Sin, of course, 2 pi m into I into del x by n. I into del x will tell you what is the current point, and m will tell you how many wavelengths you are going to include, and this distance divided by total n, the total numbers that you have. So I should have this capital N, right? Right. So for I equal to 1 to n, we are going to have this, right. So this is the old C. I am also going to define a new C of I, so that can be 0 because that will get updated, so end for. Okay. So the point behind this is to put a sinusoidal profile which goes from 0 to 1, which means it will be about average about 0.5. Okay. So this is one way of putting a sinusoidal profile. And a new C, I am just initializing the variable here. I am not giving it any value because new C will be obtained from the old C using our explicit formula, and so that will automatically get the right values when we need it. Okay. So this is the initialization that we have done, and let us plot. Old C should be plotted, and it should be plotted with a red line. Right. So whatever is red, we know is the initial profile, and then we have to say hold on, right, because we want to plot everything onto the same plot. And then what we are going to do is that for, so this is again important, k is equal to 1 to 20 for j is equal to 1 to 500, right. This is our usual trick. So the 20 plots I am going to make, and each plot is after 500 time steps. So that is the reason why these two are there, and then we need to do the actual evolution. Actual evolution will be done with using I. So we say for I is equal to 1 to n. Okay. We are going to define west as I minus 1, east as I plus 1, right? The I plus 1 point is the west east point, I minus 1 is the west point. But we do know that when we have west point as 0, so we put that condition, if west is equal to 0, then what am I going to do? West is equal to west plus n. So this is the basically the implementation of periodic boundary condition, and if east is equal to n plus 1, right, that can happen. East is equal to east minus n. Okay, I need to consistently use, right, end if. Okay, so what is this? So this is basically implementation of periodic boundary condition, right. So now, because of this, you know, only point which is expected to go below 1 is the west point, and that is only for the first point that we have taken care of. Only point that will go greater than the n is basically the east point, we have taken care of that. So this will take care of it. It is not necessary, of course, to do it this way. You can go from I equal to 2 to n minus 1, and for I equal to 1 you can always make west is this and n is that. But this is another way of doing it. So there are more than one way of implementing it. This might not be the most efficient way, because for every WE you are going to execute an if loop once. So it is costlier in terms of optimization of the code, but it makes things easier in terms of understanding. So let us keep it this way. Okay. So we have now defined. So what do? We say new C of I, remember we are still in this I loop, is equal to old C of I plus alpha times old C of I should multiply 1 plus 1 minus 2 alpha, right. Right, 1 minus 2 alpha is what the old C should multiply, plus what do we have? Plus alpha times old C west plus old C east, right. This is the new C. Remember that is the expression. So C at time t plus delta t is equal to C at time t into 1 minus 2 alpha plus alpha times C at I minus 1 and C I plus 1. That is what west and east is what we are calling in this code, right. So you do this, end the for loop for evolving. So after some time loop, so we also end the other one. But before ending the time loop, of course, we have to say for I equal to 1 to n, what do? Old C of I is equal to new C of I. Okay. Remember, we are doing explicit, keeping this old C, new C is not really required, but again, I mean, you can do it in whichever way you want. Not necessary that it has to be done only in this manner. Okay. So this is end for. So we need another end for, which will be for the J loop. J loop is for 500 time steps. So it will do this 500 times and it will end that loop. After ending that, of course, it has to plot. Plot C and then end for. So it will plot 20 times and then it will plot, and so then we can print the figure, print minus D EPSC, this is explicit periodic boundary condition dot EPS. Okay. Okay. So let us run through once more, what is it that we have done? We have done the clearing and then defining variables and all that, and we have made the initial profile here. and we have plotted the initial profile and we have held on to the figure, and then we have this plotting loop, time loop, and actually evolution loop. In the evolution loop, we define the east and west points and we implement the periodic boundary condition on them, and then we go through the usual explicit scheme, okay. And then we end the loops, we plot, and then we come out and plot the figure, okay. So, this is so let us source. I think this is explicit periodic boundary condition 1D diffusion dot OCT, okay. So, there is a problem somewhere, I have made a mistake. So, it says see undefined near line 45 column 6, let us go. Where is line 45? Plot, I should say old C, because old C is what is going to be the latest value at that point, okay. So, it did not know what the C was, okay. Alright. So, okay, again I am writing this code as we are doing the lectures, because I want you to also understand it is not like I do not get error messages, I do get it all the time. In fact, I get more than what I get when I am lecturing, because here at least I am prepared, and even then I make this many mistakes. If I am writing a code by myself, I make much more of mistakes. You should be able to read the error message or look at the result and what is happening and try to figure out what went wrong or why or how, okay. Now, something has gone wrong, because I do see that there is just one figure and in blue, but this is not what we expected, right. So, we wanted it to run for some time. So, I think the number of steps it ran is not sufficient. So, let us make the delta t to be smaller, maybe 0.01, and let us try to source. Okay, it is not clear. So, why the evolution did not take place? So, in all probability the time steps was too small, because it was 0.001, 20 into 500 is like another 1000. So, that is like just one time unit it ran. So, that is probably the reason why it gave no difference between the initial profile and the final profile. So, let us see what we get here, okay. We are getting similar result again. So, I think I will go and change things a little bit. Let me put for example, maybe, okay. So, let us make this 5000 and this 200. So, let us see what happens. It is going to take much longer to run, of course, but probably that will give us better composition profiles. See, the other thing that I am surprised is that we have only one half of the figure. So, it is not sinusoidal, okay. So, maybe we have to put m equal to, it is not one wavelength that we are finding, okay. So, I think m has to be made 2, we will come back to that. Let us see what this. Okay, so it's the code is going to take some time, and once the results come, I'll store the figure, and in the next lecture we will show how it looks, and or probably I'll play with the parameters, so that when we come back in the next lecture we can use the proper parameters, so we get the results within the time frame. So for now I'm going to stop here. And these scripts will also be available for you to work on them on your own. So, you will be able to also work with it and see what happens. Thank you.